Bethel Historical Society presents the Bethel Inn at 85, Oral Memories, presented August 6, 1998, from the Inn's South Dining Room. Dr. Stanley Howe moderated a panel of past and current members of the Bethel Inn staff. Financed primarily by William Bingham II and built under the close supervision of a six-man corporation led by Dr. John George Gehring, the Bethel Inn rose from the ashes of the partially destroyed Prospect Hotel in 1912-1913. A formal opening to the public occurred on July 12, 1913. The inn was greatly enlarged in 1928-29. From Randall H. Bennett, Bethel, Maine, and Illustrated History, 1991, page 154. Dr. Howe has opened the meeting and is just discussing how the South Dining Room was built as a result of this enlargement in 1928-29.
Dining room was among the additions. Since that time, the inn has had numerous managers, workers, and guests. We have assembled some of our memories of the inn for tonight's commemoration of the 85th anniversary of this Bethel institution, which has meant so much to this town over the years and continues to be an important factor in making Bethel the special place that all of us continue to appreciate. We are particularly grateful to the Bethel Inn for allowing us to meet here tonight for this special oral history night. We hope that we will preserve some of the memories people have of the inn so the future generations realize its importance in Bethel's past. And I want to just mention that probably some of this will come out as we go along, that one of the things I think we'd like to gather here are the number of people who have stayed here, who have been people from a wide variety of occupations of fame. We know that Chief Justice Howland Fisk Stone was here at one time. We know, I can remember in the mid-1970s, it was quite a stir over here when Paul Newman was staying here at the end of the mid-1970s. So, and I'm sure other people will have other memories of these people. So let's start with some of our questions here. And we'll start with Libby Bane. And what was your position here at the inn when you were first here, Libby?
Well, I worked here 60 years ago when I was 17. And the only restaurant I waited on, I experienced I had, was at Sadie's Restaurant on Main Street where the Bethel IGA is. So I had to train. And in those days, Bethel Inn was very elite. And you trained. You had to wear a certain shade of stocking, you wore nurse's shoes, you were immaculate, your station was immaculate. I got very good training because I was a little on the lazy side, as my family would tell you if they were alive. And I enjoyed it very much. I waited on the officers and chauffeurs and maids. The officers and chauffeurs and maids were in the side, as you come down the hall, and one of the side dining rooms. And then the officers were like Jack Carter, who was the golf pro, and then there was the housekeeper and all the office help. And you couldn't write down anything. You had to remember the whole menu. When you go out to the kitchen, there were warming ovens the whole length of the kitchen. Ralph Moore was the chef. And how I ever did it, I'll never know. But you had to remember everything that was told you. And as I progressed and was a little better trained, I had a couple tables down here in the corner where I could serve four or five people at a time. And everything was served family style, which made it easier. But I enjoyed it. And Bethel Inn has always meant a lot to me. It was a privilege for me to be able to get a position. And another thing that stood out as a young girl, everyone dressed for dinner in long evening gowns, and you'd see them stroll across the common from the Elms, and I would look at like this, you know. And of course, Pat O'Brien was on the door. He was the bellhop, and I can remember being out in the kitchen. He'd come out with magazines, and he was pretty important. And if any of us girls would try to pick up on, he'd say, nope, don't, these are not new girls. And he'd go right along his way. But his sister Brown worked with me. Mae McCrae worked in the dining room. A lot of people even remember Mae. And Grace Colvin was a waitress. there many years, and it was a very nice place, and I'm so happy I was able to work then and be trained like I was, because it really stuck with me and all my life. And after my daughter worked here in 66, she served the relishes, jams, and jellies. And I took her place that summer so she could take driver's training. And that's when I got to meet a lot of the people, because you met everybody. In those days, in 38, they also served tea every afternoon at 4. They had one girl that did just that. She made the sandwiches and served tea at 4 o'clock. So it was really, a very nice place. And I enjoyed it, although I worked at it, and it was work. I liked it very much.
I worked here in 1943 in the garden. I was the third lowest of three gardeners. My sister was the head gardener. Freddie McMillan was the next one, and I was the under gardener. It was very pleasant indeed. I was in graduate school at the time, but I was home for summer vacation, so I didn't begin to work until mid-June. My sister had been home earlier, and she had been working since March, and Freddie too, with the greenhouse and working. There was a very large flower garden out where the swimming pool is now, and stretching up toward really as far as the house which used to be the Herrick House, and that back area. And then it went also over across the street at the building which is known as the Elm. So there isn't an elm tree within a mile of the place. It was then known as the Straw House. Behind where the conference center is now, there was also a large flower garden. The inn, as Elizabeth said, was noted for being a very, very fine establishment. And the purpose of the garden was every room had to have fresh flowers every day. All of the rooms, the public rooms, like the lobbies and the local, and also every private room. So we cut flowers. There were large wooden trays, great big heavy ones, which Freddie had to carry in. Every day we carried in load after load of fresh flowers. The housekeeper at that time was Miss Carrie Philbrick, and she was extremely tough on that subject. No matter how beautiful the flowers were, and it broke your heart, because some flowers, of course, will last for several days at least, throw them out. Off of their head, so to speak, and fresh ones. And it was really, you had to keep working at it. And my sister was very strong-minded and very firm, and she could almost carry the match. But of course, you couldn't. The inn's quality was unquestioned. The inn had to be finest in everything, and the fresh flowers. And it was appreciated, because time after time after time when we were working, the guests, we always put little old ladies, they usually were, would toddle out, as my mother would say, would toddle out to tell us how much they loved the flowers. And every now and then someone would say that she'd had such a beautiful bouquet yesterday and she was sorry that it changed. But usually they said that every day they looked forward to different flowers. The working conditions actually, though, were very, very good indeed. We always felt that being out in the grounds crew, we missed the internecine warfare that existed in some cases between various factions inside. Though I want to stress it was a very lovely place in which to work. But Ralph Moore, the chef, Freddie used to get the news for us and bring it back, you see. Ralph Moore, the chef, was very temperamental, and he had a slight speech defect, and they all used to tease him. For example, he used to say, he couldn't say the word equipment, and he said nipment. So they'd call Rob Sculling, and everyone, we fully nipped around here, nipped, and he'd just explode. And then occasionally one waitress would get something, and another waitress would go right after her, because I say the standards were very, very high indeed. We reported directly to G.L. Thurston, who was the head of the outside of the inn, and he was, of course, a local man and well-known. He was very genial and very easy. easygoing, but everybody respected him. He was easygoing in the sense of his temperament. But of course, the inn standards were kept right up. The outside crew, there were three of us in the garden. There were the people on who did the golf course. That was Ted Heath. And I think that Leslie Coleman drove the tractor at times, but Fred, Ted Heath did, mainly was the golf course man. And the golf course, Ted didn't mow the greens, he manicured them. Absolutely, the greens were perfect, and he worked at it constantly. The golf course was his great love. And then Leslie Coleman also drove the truck around and picked the laundry here and there, various places. And Leslie Cummings, he did the hand mowing. Those days, hand mowing meant hand mowing, not motorized. And he mowed constantly around, that's right. But there was always opportunities. Every day, we'd more or less check in. We'd hear, get the news from Freddie, or we'd get the news from Leslie Cummings, who was an extremely good reporter. He taught me a lesson about an establishment with servants, a lesson which I've never forgotten, which is there are absolutely no secrets. If you come to a hotel with servants within 5 minutes, they can tell you everybody within the place knows. Who did you come with? What is your relationship with her or him? And you ask, have you spoken to the bellhop's Maine was dry in those days until local option, Bethel had local option. Have you spoken to the bellhops about getting a little something? Because Junior George would then be, next day would be going into Berlin and would take care of various things. Within 5 minutes, there's no such thing. It's, if the CIA were half as efficient, and we all knew, and it went right round, as you say, and you always knew the news, and the GL would be around to find out his version, they'd give us his version of it and find out what everybody knew. But basically, it was a lovely place in which to work, and we were proud of the standards. And we were, I think everyone was very proud of the standards of the inn. Many years later, when I was trustee of Gould Academy, and Gould Academy had become an owner of the inn at that time, sort of through an accident, I suppose. Anyway, the Academy had hired a manager to run the inn, and by that time, the inn's economy was operating a different basis, because when Mr. Bingham was alive, there was no problem about money. Everything was taken care of. Though the inn was very expensive, the people who stayed here were all wealthy, but nonetheless, it was an expensive place to run. Anyway, when I was a trustee, I'll never forget the trustee meeting when the manager was telling us about the changes he was making. He said that to save money, he brought in polyester sheets. Well, expression on Sidney Davidson's face around the lower. Heavens, the people who sleep on polyester sheets, because the old Mrs. Wilbur did the laundry, and that was down that building, sort of down behind toward Mary Clough, Keviston's in behind there. I don't know who worked with her, whether she had a bunch of gnomes or what, but everybody had freshly ironed cotton sheets, possibly. Anyway, as I say, I don't know how they settled it, and we hastily changed the subject and got away from polyester sheets. But housekeepers from generations past were spinning in their graves and stuff.
Thank you, Margaret. Steve, what was your position, and how long did you work in that capacity?
Well, I think I'm the record. I must be the youngest. 1943, when Margaret was picking flowers, I was born. I came to the inn in 1971 when Peggy and I moved to Bethel, and Blaine Moores was the manager at the time, and I took the job that summer as his night auditor. Mr. Bingham had owned the inn until 1956, I believe, 1955, and then it sold it to Guy Butler, who had it until 66, and then it was sold to Gould Academy, and Blaine Moores was managing it for Gould Academy. I always think of myself as being in the transition zone, watching the transition of the inn. When I came in 71, people were still coming for 8 weeks of summer. And in fact, one of my extra duties was to drive down to Hartford, Connecticut in the Inn station wagon and pick up Mrs. Swearingen and bring her up to put her in room two, which was her room. And then I would go down to the railway freight station in Lewiston and pick up Judge Kincaid's trunk, because the judge always sent his trunk by railway express, and had for years and years. There was no reason to change now. And I'd bring it up, and we'd take it up to room 17, because that was where the judge and Mrs. Kincaid always stayed. And Mrs. Allen would come, and she was always in room 15. She was known as the Queen Bee. She set herself up in a throne, kind of a throne-like chair in the lobby, and everyone would gather around her. When Lay Morris decided, and I believe it was in the winter of 71-72, that the inn needed to be updated, renovated, paint and paper and everything done, he called up all of the guests who stayed in these rooms for the summer, and he asked them what color they would like their room to be. Mrs. Swearingen wanted blue. I think that Blaine made the decision that the judge would want Drums and Eagles, so he didn't get a choice on that. That was his wallpaper. That was the way it was in 1971 and in 1972. We would have activities every evening. There were magicians and musicians and various kinds of folks who worked it was like the Borscht Belt, you know, they worked the resort circuit, and they would come through and they'd be on our social calendar, and everybody would love that. One night was devoted to bingo. Blaine would call bingo. I hope there's nobody from Albany there. Saturday was always the transition time when new guests would come in, because most all of them stayed at least a week, and as I say, many for 8 weeks. But every Saturday night we would have a cocktail party before dinner. It was a big deal. Blaine and Ellen Moores and their daughters were all decked out in their finery, and would greet the guests, and we had a... It was probably similar to the tea parties of the olden days. That was always a nice event. The inn at that time was always kept up, and there was always somebody to sweep the front porches. Dot was mentioning, as we came in tonight, sometimes it was Louise Lincoln who was sweeping the front porch. But there were people here who were schooled in the old ways in the old days, and they made sure that carried on. There were, at the time, people who came up and worked the season. Frieda Clark, whose husband had been, Jim, what was he, a surgeon?
Yeah.
And she came because she wanted something to do. She worked, she lived in Sarasota, Florida in wintertime, but she came up in the summer and would stay at the inn here and work the front desk. Jim would play her to death. Dot Bartlett worked on the front desk. Favorite of the guests. People love to come back and see the employees who had been here before. The flower gardens were still going then, and I don't think there was as much emphasis on fresh flowers, but certainly there were fresh flowers in all the public spaces. Hilda Donahue was the housekeeper, and she was certainly schooled in the old ways, and she knew what every guest wanted in their room. So if Mrs. Allen wanted a particular table next to her bed, Hilda had it up in the attic, and she would bring it down the day before Mrs. Allen was to arrive and have everything set up for her. In the dining room, the waitresses all knew what the guests wanted for breakfast and would have the right number of prunes out or whatever it was. It was essential.
Mrs. Moore set flowers in the room, too, in the rooms.
That's right,
but
she did.
She back in the, because Barbara and I would sometimes have to help with those. But she saw that there was flowers in every room.
Yep. And those, that's right, so things were going along just as they had in the first part of the century, all the way up to 1971 or 72. In 72, the Moores left, and Mal and Betty Jennings came. Mal Jennings managed the inn, and I worked as his assistant for a couple of years until he left and went over to North Conway, to Intervale, where they bought their own place. And then John Gasser became the manager. And that was kind of the transition time. That there was a feeling then that the old people didn't exist anymore, and what we needed to do was get shorter stays, people who were here for golf, and forget about the old folks. And probably there were a lot of things transitioning at the same time. It wasn't just the management here, but I do think that the old stable populations were kind of forgotten about, and the new idea was to get younger people in who were more active and more interested in doing the kinds of things that the younger management was interested in doing. Just trying to figure this out. I guess it was the winter of 75, 76. I was managing the affairs of the inn through the winter. All this time, the inn was closed in the wintertime, in all of my knowledge of it. But I was in charge of seeing to it that the roofs were shoveled and place wasn't leaking, things like that. And that was the year that the inn, that Gould Academy sold the inn to Barry Harris. And I was involved in those negotiations and went down to New York City to Sidney Davidson's office in Brooklyn to be involved in the final negotiations when the inn was sold. It was a bittersweet time for everyone. That was my involvement.
Thank you. Bill?
I've had the good fortune to be the assistant manager for 5 years, and in the most recent 5 years, the general manager here at Bethel Inn. It's interesting hearing all the different takes on things. One thing I'm struck by is that, you know, today the Bethel Inn employs 110 people. The longevity of the average length of stay of a staff person is about 7 years here. We have people who have been dining room for 15, 20, 25 years. It's not uncommon for people to stay with us a long period of time. And there's a sense of family, I think, here that keeps folks here. And I think there's a generosity to the staff that has carried through the years as well, too. I think there's a huge loyalty, that sense of loyalty and a feeling that we want to be providing them high quality service. I've worked at the Myopia Hunt Club in Hamilton, Massachusetts. I worked at the Spruce Point Inn over in Booth Bay Harbor, and I've watched through the years the older clientele dwindle. And that day of taking the train in your steamer trunk and coming up for long periods of time just ended. And it wasn't, I don't think, anything that hotels did. I think it was a change in society. It's something that people could travel for 2 days and get away to a resort. They could do a shorter term thing, and that's where it went. And the year that Dick bought this place, I think in 1978, for about $400,000. My understanding was that it was doing about $300,000 in sales that year. We are going to do close to $4 million in sales this year at the inn. There's been certainly years of struggle. I'm probably guilty of changing things from cotton to polyester. We certainly don't have the flowers in the rooms. There's definitely been changes over the years, but what's striking to me is, I sit in the staff meetings with 15 members of the staff, and we've got Steve Stone, who's an American Olympic chef who's won awards. We've got Evan Connors, who tirelessly spends hours out on the golf course. We've got Sue Farnham, who's been in the dining room here with us for 10 years. We're building this new wing on the front of the inn, and it's being named the Chapman Wing after Ida Chapman, who has been here for 25 years. I think there's still a strong sense of that history, and it's an exciting time for us here.
That's exciting to hear.
Ida was a wonderful waitress. I didn't get to know until, of course, I came back to take my daughter's place in, I think, 66, and she was waiting on the table then.
Yep.
Wonderful waitress.
Yep.
And very well liked the daughter and the bills.
One of the exciting things about the Bethel is that people who come here or have come here remember it and remember it fondly. And of course, just like all guests, they come back to see what's
the same and what's different. I remember particularly one time being on the desk in 1971 or 72, checking in someone late at night, and this fellow said, you know, I haven't been here since 1930. And I said, well, Mrs. Sully was the manager then. He said, that's right. He said, the night I was here, some rowdy boys from town threw a stick of dynamite on the lawn. Well, I grew up with some Bethel stories, because my father grew up in Bethel. I said, that was my father! He said, well, Mrs. Sully wasn't very happy about that. General impression and working conditions, I think. So why don't we move on to, do we have any favorite stories at the end? Libby, you have some favorite stories?
I think I had more. I really didn't get to mingle too much being a lowly trainee, but there's a lot of good times. And when I came back, as I said, I was probably about Grace Colburn's age, who I thought was pretty strict out in the back room when she was training Sis Brown and I to behave, telling us to behave, but there's a lot of good times. I don't want to tell all
of them. For the record.
It was quite a thing, as I said, of course I was the old one in the dining room taking Barron's place. But the boys used to yank off each other's bow ties and throw them down the laundry chute, and they'd have to run downstairs and get the bow ties out of the laundry. And as I said, then there were several different things. My memory is failing, probably for the best. But we really had a good time. And of course, that, and those, when I came back then, they had a relish girl, and a girl that did jams and jellies. That's all she did, was pass jams and jellies in the morning. And at noon, the relishes, and at night, the relish tray at night, with mints and all the fineries, you know, at night. And they kept that going until I think Mr. Gasser came, and then that was done away with. But that was the best job in at the hotel, because all you had to do was wash your relish tray after the leave. But when I worked here in 38, every Tuesday, every waitress stayed and cleaned every piece of silverware in their station, plus all the individual silver coffee pots and all the heavy silverware pieces. I've never worked so hard in my life. I was known to be a little bit lazy at home, as I said. And as I said, you stayed, and your pay wasn't very big, but you didn't think anything about it. And you had your meals, which I never was so thin in my life because the food wasn't very good that year, Bill. I hope you know. That's when they say they served the help in the help's dining room out in the kitchen. You could have three meals a day, and that was included with your wages, which I think was something like $10 or $12 a week, $12, $13, something like that. And your tips, if you were lucky. Because my station didn't pay very well.
Margaret, do you have some favorite stories about people's right you heard of?
Well, my acquaintance with the inn was not just from working here, but because for many, many years my father played golf here and made a number of friends among the guests. Early in his golfing career in the late 1920s, he was at the inn when one of the guests, a lady with spectacles, was hit hard in the eye with a golf ball that shot off the first tee, you know. And it could have been quite difficult. Unfortunately, my father was there, and he was a doctor, as you all know, and was able to get the glass extricated from the eye and one thing to another taken care of, and got her to the hospital right away. And Mr. Blackwood was so pleased that he gave the doctor free golf privileges for the rest of his life. Took him up on, of course, with a great alacrity. And he was a good golfer, and he was also a good friend of Jack Carter, the pro. And as a result, a number of the guests became very good friends. And they came back year after year, and they used to come and visit my mother in the garden, and then they'd talk about the doctor and playing golf. And at that time, up until about 1931 or 32, the inn was open in the winter, and sometimes guests would be here over the weekend, or over the Christmas vacation, I should say, for a brief time. Now, the winter time at that time, this was before alpine skiing had graduate, and then it was a toboggan which ran from back of the tennis courts, way down over across the bridge and went up in the other side. And it was perfectly wonderful. And the townspeople, the relationship with the inn was formal and very good. And that is, the townspeople obviously didn't use the inn's facilities or make free. At the same time, people came and went easily. For example, in September, when school started, the school children lived on the Songo Pond Road out there, the Bartlett sisters and some, always walked across the golf course on their way to work. They'd come across the bridge and up over the golf course. And some of the old ladies would be having breakfast here. And they always told my mother how much they loved watching the kids come up and go across the school. It was perfectly natural, I mean. And so when the toboggan slide was there, if no one was using it, town students, town children, if you got your sled and got out there and asked permission, you could go down the slide without it. Then in the middle of the Depression, I think it was probably about 1930 or 1931, the inn closed for the winter, except for a skeleton crew to shovel roofs and so forth. And it didn't open up again until skiing, because it was a big, big thing. I don't know. I do remember that these guests, as I say, became sort of a special type of friends that kind of come in every summer. And after Mr. Blackwell left and Mr. Scott came, they liked him very much. He was a good manager, but he had some of the people he brought with him to work, of course, weren't local people. It weren't the same thing. And he had brought in two or three elderly waitresses who waited table in his hotels for years and years and years. And I remember one of the guests, Mr. Morton, of the Morton Salt, you know, it never rains but it pours. He was a good friend, a lousy golfer. He was complaining bitterly to my mother. He said, some of those old women are flat-footed. He said, you shouldn't have a waitress who's flat-footed.
Thank you, Margaret. I have a letter from Bert Brown, and one of the stories he tells in here, he says, my father wanted to have a vegetable garden across the street from where we lived on Mill Hill, the present site of the Merrill's mobile home down the hill here. Land was owned by the inn when Guy Butler had the property. Mr. Butler told my father he could do it as long as he, my father, kept the Brown kids off the golf course. The garden was big and bountiful, and we still went into the golf course. We would find lost balls, sell them to golfers. I remember buying a hula hoop with some of the proceeds at Brown's Variety. Steve?
Well, lots of strange things would happen. Jimmy was around at night. You were a night watchman for a while, weren't you, Jim? Strange things would happen at night, but one particular night, I was doing the audit, and suddenly we had the old PBX system where you had to push, you know, put the cords into the room numbers, like the old Brian Pond phone system, and suddenly one of the room phones lit up, and I knew that it was Aunt Molly's room. Aunt Molly was up in 14 or somewhere, and I answered the phone and asked her if she was all right, if she needed anything, and all I could hear was heavy breathing. Aunt Molly was about, you know, in her early to mid-80s, and she used to send somebody, probably Jim, down to the Dr. Green's every day for medicine. She was quite partial to remove or something. But Sherry, I guess. I couldn't get her to respond, and all I could hear was this moaning and heavy breathing, so I called Hilda Donahue, who was the head housekeeper and was living in the inn. And Hilda went in, and I went up to see what was going on. Well, it seems that Aunt Molly had a little much medicine that day, and she'd fallen out of bed. Fortunately, in the process, she had knocked the phone off the hook, or I wouldn't have known what had happened. But she was very, very embarrassed when I showed up, and I think I called Blaine Moore, as he came over as well. And she was most embarrassed because she didn't want Blaine or me to see her without her teeth. And she was trying to find her teeth to put them back. The other remembrance I have was a couple, and I can't remember their names. The people who came in for these long stays were folks I guess you'd characterize as being very comfortable with their money. They weren't trying to make a pretense of anything. They had their lives and their careers, and they were very, very comfortable where they were in their station in life. This fellow had been a ship chandler in New York City. Dot probably remembers his name.
Swan.
There you go. Yep. Anyway, Mr. and Mrs. Swan were playing shuffleboard one day, and I was out for some reason or other. I happened by the shuffleboard court and was watching, and it was not going well. In fact, I guess they were playing against another couple, so they were at opposite ends. And Mr. Swan would shoot a puck down, and it landed 10 off. And Mrs. Swan would yell bloody murder at him, "What's the matter with you?" And he'd send another one down, and it would end in 10 off, and she'd yell again, and just kept going. Finally, he turned to me and he said, "My good man, do you have single rooms in this establishment?" "I think I need two."
Anybody is. And I don't have too many, I don't remember
company, except that Maria Von Trapp would stop over each year, and people would kind of go gaga, and you hear people running through the inn saying, "The Baroness is coming, the Baroness is coming."
Stan?
Yes?
I happened to be on duty one night. I was bellhop out front, and we'd gotten a lecture about how our guests were to be treated and these number of things. Well, 3 o'clock happened to be the person on duty at the front desk, and right against the column near the front desk was where the bellhop sat. While I was sitting there, it was getting around 11 o'clock, and a Robin's Egg blue car and he pulled in. And I looked out, and these two women got out, and they truly looked like peasants. And I thought to myself, oh God, they're not going to try to come in here. Well, I turned to Frieder and I said, "Wait until you see what's going to come through the door." Well, these two women in this, what I consider an outrageous costume, came in. And she took one look at them. I'm standing there waiting to see how she's going to get rid of them. And she does this little curtsy and she starts bowing and scraping. I thought, what is going on here? And the next thing I heard, now we have this lovely room, Baroness, and she's going on and on and on. So she turned to me and she said, "Jim, would you get the Baroness Von Trapp's luggage?" So I thought, this is the sound of music. I don't know how anybody, you are a Baroness? And she was probably one of the rudest people I have ever met in my life. She was terrible. I couldn't wait to get her into her room. Keith Davis was on the next morning, and so I left him a note. I said, "Wait until you see what comes out of 15 tonight."
Okay. What about the question of Jews at the inn? I don't think they allowed Jews or knowingly allowed Jews here in the early days. Do you know anything about that, Margaret?
If they had the policy, they certainly never articulated it or spoke about it. After Hitler invaded Austria, there was a good number of Jewish physicians, of course, Austrian Jewish physicians who came to Boston. And some of them came up here to the inn on a conference. They had met the various doctors that Mr. Bingham was fond of in the Boston area, Dr. Proger in particular. And I remember my father coming home, he was terribly impressed. He'd been talking with a Dr. Tannenbaum, who had been one of these doctors. And of course, they were splendid physicians. I think that I've read somewhere that the Jewish doctors that came over, one of the reasons American medicine took a great leap up because of the stimulus of what they were able to bring in. And of course, as we all know, Mr. Bingham and his family were very much medical. They were groupies for medicine, almost, in a very dignified way, but their attitude about it. And I remember my father coming home and he said, "I told Sam that I was delighted. I'd never had such a good time as I had with Dr. Tannenbaum." He said, "I was really thought it was a good thing that the inn had the Jewish doctors in." But I didn't, certainly, as I say, everyone was too well bred ever to articulate policy. And it may not have been a policy, it may have been, or if it was a policy, it might have been breached on occasion, for special possessions.
I think that, as I say, I was at a transition time. I think that a lot of the normal guests of the inn had their own feelings about the religion.
Oh, yes, there was. They were a very conservative group. They were lovely people, a lot of them. They were lovely. But when I say conservative, I mean really William McKinley type.
One of my jobs was to take the guests on scenic safaris time to time, and I had a man lower them over at we had lunch and we were looking around, and at that time the hotel was run by the Dodge and was just kept up right up the snub. And everybody seemed to be having a wonderful time, and they had the list of arriving guests posted at the desk and everything. And the folks that I had with me from the Bethel Inn all went and looked at the list. And I thought they'd probably look and see if any of their friends were there. Well, as we walked out, Mr. Swan said to somebody else, "What'd you figure?" And the other one said, "About 80%. I said, "What are you folks talking about?" He said, "Juice." That was the deal. They knew. We didn't know if there was any kind of problem.
Certainly African Americans would be welcome here in that period. We're probably unreported to those days.
I don't remember hearing there was an African American employee, a girl named Dora, who was here. She used to ride around in the truck with Charles Toole. I think she worked somewhere in the laundry. Now that you remember Elizabeth,
what about the chauffeurs?
Yeah, but certainly no guesses that'd be allowed.
Oh, I don't remember hearing of it.
I remember Charlie too.
Well, Stanley, that wasn't unusual. I never saw an African American until I went to college. I mean, they didn't exist. They're not very common in Maine anyway, but they certainly weren't common in Bethel.
Rudy Honkler tells that wonderful story of an African American woman arriving at the Crawford House and how they had to ease her out. So they let us stay, but they got rid of her the next day, you see. So it happens, I guess.
I don't ever remember
Randy, do you have something you
want to
say?
Well, no, I don't ever remember.
When we were compiling material for the Illustrated History of Bethel, of course, we went through a society's very extensive collection of Bethel Inn brochures and pamphlets and what have you. And I think we only found one out of about maybe 30 or 35. Four-page folded brochure about the inn, probably dating from the early 1920s, where on the last page, at the very bottom of the page, in very fine print, it said Christian clientele. And I wondered about that, and I noticed it and happened to look at the brochures before and after, and I never found it again. And I always wondered if someone, you know, perhaps Mr. Bingham or someone involved in the inn at that time saw that, and they decided that it really wasn't a good idea, wasn't something good to.
I vaguely remember something about just only the Christian, you know. And I asked Stanley about it because I didn't want to say anything because I wasn't sure. But he said that there was, you know, they didn't say too much, but they didn't.
We only found one book. I thought
it was interesting. Well, Margaret Oakes and her memories told me that it was an unwritten rule that no Jews were allowed at the inn, so I didn't know how they carried it out. And of course, some people might have got in without anyone knowing. It was a really different time, a different era that time. So
I think, sadly, that Jewish people who could afford the Bethel Inn would have known through their own circles. I mean, they how where they went and where they didn't go. I mean, all the Jewish people, girls I knew in college who came from that group. They lived a very special social life of their own, and they were extremely proud and would never, as I say, they knew that sort of thing to avoid embarrassment.
Okay, we're at the point where we maybe ask the audience for more comments or questions. Does anybody have any comments or questions? Yes, Nan.
The first winter that we were here, which I think was the first winter, in 1960, the inn was open. For the AT&T people.
Yeah,
and that gave, I guess, some experience of how many skiers might have come. But of course, that was the first winter that Mount Abram was open. That was Sunday River's second winter. Something else that you said, Paul Newman came to visit us.
Really?
And I thought he looked vaguely familiar. But I was kind of, but when she spoke, there's no voice like it.
Oh, I would guess sometime in the early 30s. I don't know, Steve. I remember
they raised their own beef, their own vegetables.
Yes, the food was wonderful. And the menu, Elizabeth and I were talking about the menu. The menu was like the menu we get on board ship. You know, we had absolutely everything. And you could pick and choose, and you could eat the entire menu. Whatever. And everything, all the vegetables Oxford County Medical Association, and this is the ideal place. The doctors were always given a good grade, but you see, we're exactly halfway between Rumford and Norway, South Paris, and so it was always meant for Bethel Inn. But as I say, there were always fresh vegetables and there were always fresh things, and native corn was really native corn, that sort of thing.
There are some old menus and some old brochures and some pictures around the outside of the room if you want to look at them afterwards.
Oh, you
there's
said one, you have some old menus?
Yeah, there's a 1933 menu, I think, back there, and maybe even the one a little earlier.
Can you imagine the waitresses standing up and remembering that menu and going out to the dining, out to the kitchen, and they have warming ovens, a whole, you know, a long row of warming ovens, and you put up the right dish, or you got it from the cooks and back, too.
In the early 70s, they were still having the menu for each meal printed at the Citizen office. And it was all the type, of course, had to be set.
I had one from 66 that Louis Lincoln let me take, 1966.
That was quite a panic to get the menus down to the printer and get them back for lunch and back for dinner.
Any other questions or comments? Yes, Amy?
I'd just like to say that in the 30s, I was one of the summer complaints. My family came here for the summer, and I came always in the month of August. There was a couple from Brooklyn, New York, who came and stayed 2 weeks in August. And of course, we got invited to dinner at the inn when they were here. And my sister, Priscilla Carver Wiley, and I would also be invited. And while our parents and the people whom we were visiting played bridge at night, my sister and I would run around the inn, and we would go up and down that metal stairway at what was then known as the Harriet. And we had more fun doing that. I hope you're going to remember that laugh. Don't take it down. It was a lot of fun. It really was. And the flowers, I can remember those flowers. And I used to think they were just gorgeous. And in the 40s, when Peter Scott was here, my sister and I were friendly with their daughter, his daughter, MG, and we would come in to the inn anytime. She said, come anytime, come up to the room. So we just really had free reign of the whole place.
And they went right into you?
Yes, they did. And Mrs. Scott for a while. And then they had GL's barn that's now L'Auberge.
Right.
Mrs. Scott was the flower arranger, and she was always fixing the flowers. Nice memories.
Other comments, questions? Carol?
Stanley, I remember many times that I was called from guests at the inn to see if I would be willing to play bridge with them. And it was not only fun to play bridge, but also to socialize and find out where they lived and all about their trips and so forth.
Other comments, questions? Alan?
I never worked here, but in the 50s when I was going to Gould, the meat for the inn used to come by Railway Express. It used to come up on train 16 in the morning, get it up around 11 o'clock. My mother would pick me up at Gould at 12 when we had a lunch break. We'd go to the railroad station, get the barrel of meat, bring it up the wooden barrel, mind you. And Ralph Moore would never sign for it, but he got his butcher knife, cut the canvas out of the top of the barrel and checked it to make sure it was okay. The Swift Company in Portland, I think he thought that my mother and I was taking some of the meat out, but we got it. And then in the 60s, Arthur Herrick was, it maintained the Greensmoors and the Fairway Moors here at the inn for many years. He was getting ready to move to Florida. Arthur was Susan's granddad. And he says, Alan, he says, you're young. He says, I think you ought to buy my business and continue to do this as a part-time job. I said, what do I want to do that for? And he said, I'll teach you how to do it, how to sharpen the moors. So I went ahead and bought Arthur's machinery and and tended the greensmoors and the fairway moors here for many years, until they got in such poor management they couldn't pay their bills. And after that, a few years later, Guy Butler sold the inn, and he and his new bride were looking for a place to spend the summer, and they rented our cottage up the summer, my wife and I, and they liked it so well they stayed two summers. Then the second summer they said, well, we'd like to marry again. We said, no, we want to use it ourselves. So we ended up buying the place next door. And he was just the best neighbor you could ever have. He was really an old stuffed shirt around the inn here, I think. Yeah. But after he got away from here, he was a different person. He was just the nicest neighbor you could ever have. And those are just some memories I have of some Bethel Inn folks.
Other questions, comments, Carol?
I remember what I think was the last opening in the winter that continued. And that, I think, was 1979. We stayed in the Oaks, and I can remember that night going to bed, and it was the most horrible clatter you ever heard. The plumbing pipes hadn't been used, I guess, for years, and it was just terrible.
Steam pipes were hammer, I guess.
Jane?
This is an entirely different kind of comment. It just shows what a small place the world is. Dick and I lived in Western Massachusetts, 12 miles out of Boston for 35 years. We had heard of Charles Hubbard, Robert Winter, Horace Sears, who were very well thought of in the community, suburban community of Western, before our time. And I come up here to the Bethel Inn, and the bronze plaque in the lobby has their names on. Did they help finance this place with
I think there were five folks that worked with Mr. Bingham.
They were all listed, they're listed out here as of Boston. I knew them as bankers, all three different banks, but living in the town of Weston.
I think they were all devotees of Dr. Gearing, too, and dedicated to the end of the doctor.
Very famous people in Massachusetts.
Yeah, you read the book, An Experiment in Medicine. See if you can find it. It details the history of Mr. Bingham and his doctors. And whenever I have a medical student staying at the inn in the wintertime, I have to read the book, and he said, oh, I know all these names. I go to school in these buildings. So they're all the people who were involved with Dr. Gearing and with the inn, who, you're right, are a famous folk in Boston.
The New England Medical Center, though, has wings. Farnsworth Wing and the Bingham Wing and the all of these names.
Dexter?
Yeah, I think I'm correct that the Gould Academy still owns that plaque, even though it's hanging in the field.
Is that correct? It's made by Tiffany in New York.
Well, it was one thing that Sydney didn't want to deed over.
I see. Any other comments before we adjourn? I think we've had a great discussion here tonight. We've only covered just a small portion of the history of the inn, but I hope we've given people some insights and ideas about the inn. I hope you'll join us in the back. We're going to have punch and a birthday cake for the inn's 85th birthday. So I hope you'll join us in the back here. Thank you all for coming, and thank you all for participating in the panel.
Well, thank you, Stan.